Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who is truly the author and the finisher of our faith. It is truly a blessing to be here on this Sunday morning. I want to call your attention to John chapter 8 and verse 12. John chapter 8 and verse 12. John chapter 8 and verse 12. It reads, Then spake Jesus again unto them, saying, I am the light of the world. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. So reach the word of God. Simple but yet powerful. Then spake Jesus again unto them, saying, I am the light of the world. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life.
Say that.
I want to talk for a moment about light and darkness. Light and darkness. What was light like before Christ? Can you be able to imagine how light was before knowing that you was walking in complete darkness? Can you remember how changed light was when you accepted who Christ is? You have come into the knowledge of knowing who Christ is to now. I'm not oblivious to what's going on around me. I see the wrong. I acknowledge the wrong. I stay away from the wrong and keep my eyes stayed upon Christ. The songwriter wrote, This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. Everywhere I go, I'm going to let it shine. Jesus gave it to me, I'm going to let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Are you and I letting our light shine? It's a wonderful question to ask, because sometimes in this life, our spiritual bulbs go dim. Mm-hmm. And sometimes when they have gone dim for so long, they go completely out. Here, as we're looking, what is God's solution to the darkness of the world? We must turn on the light. It's like flipping on a switch. When you walk into a dark room. It's dark when you first walk in, but you flip the switch and now you can see everything that's around. Instead of cursing the darkness, just turn on the light, investigating of what's surrounding us. Darkness parallels life. Darkness speaks of death, ignorance, and sin. Where light is evidence of life, where darkness, it shows how we are sinful, ignorant, but yet light speaks of knowledge and holiness. The light reproves sin, it reproves it. The lost sinner lives in darkness and will spend eternity in darkness if he rejects Christ. Here is our personal, reflection of our own life. Are we really showing Christ? Or am I showing what this world wants me to see? The world is truly a dark place. You cannot get nowhere on your own. Amen. We have a way of mentality nowadays to where if you want anything, you got to get it yourself. Man will not give you anything. Man will not give you a bed, a bite to eat, or a cup of water to drink, nor a place to lay your head. I found out over the years that if you and I are not willing to work hard for it, you cannot obtain success or blessings. Amen. So we see here that this is basically trying to give us helpful information about what type of God we are truly serving. The war in Iraq, if you want to give it any information, says the war in Iraq has determined that when they encounter darkness, we cannot curse it out, shout it out, or bomb it out. We may temporarily put some participation or practices of darkness out of our business, but the only way to remove darkness is to release the light. Sometimes you just got to let Jesus shine through. Sometimes you can't fight situations. We have to just let go and let God. John is the writer of this wonderful book. He tells us that Jesus is the heavenly light Jesus is the heavenly light for earthly darkness. He writes about AD 85 through 90. The son of Zebedee and Solomon and the younger brothers of James, John, theme is Christ Jesus, the divine son of God. The first three gospels are called the synoptic gospels, which from the Greek word that means to see together. They give an overview of the life of Christ, but yet God is basically showing us the blueprint to success as a Christian. Here he gives us an understanding. He says Matthew, Mark, and Luke all view the life of Christ in a similar way, each with one of his own emphasis. Matthew pictures Christ as the King of the Jews. Mark shows Christ as the servant and writes for the Roman. Luke views Christ as the Son of Man writing for the Greek. But John presents Christ as the Son of God and writes for the whole world. So that means that I'm not just covering a group of people. I'm not covering just one nation, but I want to be able to make sure that everybody get the same picture. That's what we see here as we're preparing to deal with this wonderful look at John's gospel. It is the conflict between faith and unbelief. He writes that Jesus is the way, but they will not walk with him, the truth, but they will not believe him, the life, but they will kill him. Isn't that amazing that Jesus knew that people were still going to rebuke him? People were not going to trust him. People were not going to confide in him. But yet he still gave his life for them. Amen. Jesus is the light in this darkness. He goes on and he says, John begins his gospel with "in the beginning" and evidence. The phrase "from" it refers the reference to the point and time, the beginning of creation. In the beginning, he deals with the creation and the time of absolute pre-existence before any creation. The beginning is no beginning. Here, John just starts. He starts from the same point of Genesis, but goes upward, thus talking us into the eternity perspective time, that God is just one eternal now. Uh-huh. That means that God is everything that you and I could ever need. If I need help, I know I can get it from God. If I need knowledge, I can get it from God. If I need understanding, if I need some love, I need some joy, I need some understanding, I need some commitment, I can get it. I can get it from God. He goes on, he says, there can only be life in the physical world without light. He said there can be no light. I'm sorry. He said there can be no light in this physical world without light. We need to be able to see what's going on. We need to be able to know that in this life, God is our light beacon that keeps us in the awareness of what's going on or what we have in our lives. He tells us, he says in John chapter 1, verses 3 through 5, it says, all things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. Yeah. He says, and the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. Can never extend it without Christ. That means that we cannot be able to say that I have the light, the knowledge, the understanding without saying that I have the relationship, the love of Christ. He goes on, he shares with us. He says one of the words we are familiar with in the word, he says, he tells us literally, he says it means that we are to put together with light. He says God is centrally, basically he's saying that we are to be the light of the world, but he tells us that God is our battery. That's amazing, because we have everything that we need, we will never go out. That means that's like, just giving an example of a good battery. They say that energy is supposed to be a good battery because it keeps going and going and going.
Amen.
But the life expectancy is not like God. He gives us instance. He says, for instance, glucose is a similar sugar that is the basic energy source for various of all organisms on earth. In addition, the oxygen that we need to breathe and stay alive, it is produced as a byproduct. He says, even these so-called fossil fuels, such as coal and plutonium, that we have can depend on the producing of what we need. But we have here in God everything that we need to keep on living. We have here in God. God gives us everything. He says in Genesis chapter 1 and verse 3, when God began to turn a coast into a custom, he brought forth light. God does not have to take your life for you to cease to exist. All he has to do is stop giving.
Amen.
Pull the breath away. We cannot inhale and exhale any longer. Remove the sight. No longer can we be able to see. Remove the hearing. No longer can we hear. Remove the ability to move. No longer can we walk, run, or jog. If it had not been for God who was on our side, where would we?
All right.
Would we be? Jesus is the light in a world of full of chaos. Criminal processes, and yet God is what gives us safety in the midst of a world that's setting themselves up for failure and destruction. Can you imagine with all the national disasters that is going on in the world, but yet God seems to always provide for his own. No matter what city, no matter what state his people is in, God continues to provide even in spite of. Jesus is the light of the world. In a bad situation, God still shows up and says, I still show you that I'm providing.
All right.
Texas, for example. I remember hearing a little story of a gentleman that's in Texas. He said that there are so many people that are giving money to do all of these particular organizations, but yet none of the money is getting to the people. But yet they make sure that some of the people are getting some of the resources. It's not about how the money's being spent, but it's about the resources getting to the people. How many times have we looked into our lives about trying to just give to God? God is the light of the world. He is what sustains us in a world that's destined to kill us all. We know that the enemy's job is to steal, to kill, and to what? Destroy. That means his mentality is, if I take enough from you, you're going to want to curse God. If you get sick enough, if you get close to death, you're going to want to curse God and ask God, why did you allow me to get into this predicament? Lord, why did you allow me to have to suffer like I'm suffering? And yet God said, I have been with you always.
All right.
We sing our song so many times. Walk with me, Lord.
Amen.
Walk with me. We've seen the poem of the footprints in the sand, and it tells the story of an individual who was walking with God, and after some time they began to ask, Lord, well, Lord, you was walking with me at the very first beginning, but now why haven't I began to see? It started out with two footprints, but now I only see one. He says, Lord, where was you? Have we found ourselves in our dark situation of our life and have asked God, Lord, where was you?
when my problems were too heavy for me. Lord, where was you when my family abandoned me? Where was you when my friends were talking about me and belittling me? Well, Lord, where was you? And in the story of the poem of the footprints in the sand, he says, I was the one that was carrying you. The feet that you were seeing were mine. When you could not walk no more, I had to hold you. When you got tired, I was the one that was carrying you. God was right there in the midst of everything that you go through. There are storms we find ourselves going through. God is there. There are some teary days, but God is there. There are some times where we've been neglected, overwhelmed, and yet God is right there. Sometimes you have to encourage yourself and are able to tell yourself, I know for a fact that God said that he would never leave me, nor would he forsake me. That is a confirmation for yourself about a promise that God has given, that no matter who's around me, God will always be there with me.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Isn't that assuring to know?
Yes.
Light.
Thank you.
Light in this darkness. There are so many people that are in darkness.
Yes.
We have to be a light to the people.
Amen.
Sometimes we allow our behaviors to hinder people from coming to the light.
Yes.
We sing Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I love Amazing Grace because it helps me to realize that I used to be one of them people that walked in
love. Right.
Yes. Yes.
That's the encouragement about it. But this is what I found out. My darkness might not be like the next person's darkness. My situation might not be like the another person's situation, but it's still darkness. He gives us the understanding. He gives us the help. He gives us the resources to know that God is still providing. And I began to think about this because when I began to study on this, I asked myself a few questions. I just want you to think about it for a moment. If it had not been for God that has allowed you to see this day,
all right,
yeah. Not this year, but this day, this moment, what would you be? What would you be doing if it had not been for God who has kept you?
All right.
If it had not been for God who has provided for you, what would you be doing? Where would you invest your time in? Right now, if you didn't have to come to church today, where would you invest your time in right now? It's important. And the reason why I'm asking this is because sometimes we get so busy in life to where I have no time for God. Sun can be out, beautiful day outside, and I'm stuck in home. If anything does not sit well in us, it should be our sin. It should be the time where we so engulfed with what goes around to where we have lost sight of God. See, this is a judgmental world. And in this world, nobody cares who is at the top. It's more of a crab-like mentality. I'm going to pull down the next person so I can assume that I'm going to get where they are. But you have to look at some things. You have to look at what we're doing in our lives. We have to look at how we're living. How we're talking, how we are working, and that helps us to see whether we're going to be blessed or whether we are basically cursing ourselves.
All
right. Light and darkness. He says this chapter shows Christ in conflict with the Jewish leaders and presents a series of important characteristics. It is easier in the morning, it's early in the morning, and Jesus in the midst of the teachers and in the temple, the scribes and the Pharisees brought these women caught and abused, and Jesus in the court, and the women, and the treasurer, section in the temple, the rules, but yet he was basically saying with them that you have to change what you are doing. You are the leaders. You are the one that helps to set the guideline. And yet you are the one that's sending people to hell.
All right.
Do we not see that today? Do we not see that people who are in positions are the same people who have no knowledge? Isn't that what we see today? That the same people that's supposed to be helping are the same people who are digging ditch after ditch and stabbing after stabbing. Isn't that what we see in today's society? And then we divide ourselves not because we are better, but we divide ourselves because we say we are better and we have no knowledge what is better.
All right. Amen. Amen.
Who's to say that one religion is better than the next? Look at the doctrine of it. You have to study yourself. The Bible says study to show thyself approved. That's what the word says. You're not taking a man's word, but you're looking for it yourself. And that's what happens a lot of times, that places us in a dog situation. It's because I'm too busy following somebody who is not willing to study themselves.
Amen. Amen.
That's like the blind leading the blind. Or better yet, another phrase that you say, that's like the pot calling the kettle black. We cannot be what God called us to be by trying to destroy something or somebody else. We have to focus on God, and God will show us what needs work on.
That can only, he gives us a knowledge, and he shares with us. He says, now Moses and the law commanded us that such should be stoned. But what did you have to say about it? This is the whole point, to catch Jesus, not to punish the women. People have done things in their lives. Back then they used to kill people for doing things that were not right. And we do it today. We don't do it sometimes physically, but verbally we'll wear it out. Talk about you scandalizing, belittling, and that's what we think that God is pleased with. We talked about it in our Sunday school lesson, how Abraham's family, over generation, they had assumed that just because people back then were not circumcised, they weren't clean. But I'm here to tell you today, if our heart's not right, we're in the same boat. I can be in the church, I can be in the church 20, 30, 40, 50 years, and still have a messed up heart. But yet I say that I serve God. How can we serve God? How can we be light to people and we're destructive? It's like a stick of dynamite. At any moment, I'm ready to explode. We see here in the text, it helps us to see that God is basically telling us we have to make sure that we are right with God. As long as we're right with God, God will help us to get right with each other.
He gives us three illustrations
that's very helpful to this text, because when we look at verse 12, he says, then spake Jesus again unto them, saying, I am the light of the world. He deals, number one, he deals with the presence. He says, I am. The The first person singular presents indicates a prelude from the primary and defective verse, I exist, used only when emphatic the light of the word. He says, listen, he says, without me, nothing could have been come to fruition. That's what we see here. He's basically saying, without me, nothing or no one would be here. That's the amazing part about this light that God gives. He says, without me, all of you would be in darkness.
Oh, yes.
Remember, watching that. Remember when Adam sinned in the garden, we was all what? Sinful. From that moment forth. Now imagine, all of us have had a father. All of us have experienced that position to where we had a parent that was what? Unpleased with us.
Amen.
Imagine father. Imagine your dad. Turns his back on you. And the only way that father, that daddy, that my grandfather, that my parent would turn back and receive me was that somebody that had a pureness step in for us. We walked in darkness. We was overwhelmed by darkness. And it puts me in a mindset to think about where God has brought us from.
Oh, yes.
Do you not know that God did, he could not have lived. If he wanted to, you would not be here now.
Amen.
He gives us the illustration. He tells us in the presence, he tells us that I am the one. If it was not for me, you would not be here. But then he tells us, not only is he dealing with the presence, but then he deals with the promise. Because he says, if that follow me, he says, he that followeth me shall not walk, which is live in darkness. I get tired, you get tired of having to go through things by yourself. Keep in mind, now we sing the song every now and then, I'll go if I have to go. I'll sing if I have to sing. I'll pray if I have to pray. By myself.
Right.
But let me share something with you. Every now and then, you want a little help. God gives us a promise to know that you don't have nothing to worry about because I am right here with you. Not only did he give us the presence, and not only did he give us the promise, but then he gives us a possession. He says, but shall have the light of life. And that goes to the song, This Little Light of Mine. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna let it shine. Mm-hmm. This tells us, it gives us a knowledge to know that God is engulfing us with him.
Amen.
It's like medicine. You have taken medicine for so long, it is what in our system.
Uh-huh.
And while it is in our system, we know that God is in the midst of working things through us. You don't have to worry about what you face. You don't have to worry about what you're dealing with. Just trust God.
All right.
That's why we sing some of the song that we sing. Speak to my heart. If you can use anything, Lord, I got a mind to live for Jesus. Order my steps. Just to name a few. But it all helps us to understand about who Jesus is.
Yes.
I found out that God is, he has so many names to where we can't even make mention of them all.
Mm-hmm.
We know that God is the light of the world. Mm-hmm. We know that he is the bread that nobody else would hunger anymore. We know for him to be the water that we would never thirst anymore. We know that he is our joy. We know that for him to be our peace. We know that for him to be our understanding. We know that he can be the one that we can confide in. We know that he is the one that preaches and teaches to us. We know that he is the one that disciplines us as well as console us. We know that God, we're talking about the Almighty Father, we know that he is the one that created us in his image and in his likeness. We know that he said that when he created us, there was nobody else that was made like you. So we have been made to be what God has brought us to be in his likeness.
Yes, so yes.
That's why sometimes we have to be able to see your way through the problem that you and I face sometimes, because in life you find yourself in a dark place, in a dark situation, and the only way that you can come out is to reach out and touch God.
Yes.
It's like the woman with the issue of blood. She didn't care who she bumped into. She didn't care what nobody said. She said, if I could just touch the hem of his garment, I know for a fact I will be made whole. How many of us today know that in life, if I can just touch the hem of God's garment? But then I had to try and close with this. If it had not been for God who went to Calvary's cross and then had to die and then get up the third day with all power in his hand, then I would have something to be worried about. But now, since I know that God has died, we know that he has gotten up the third day with all power in his hands, I don't have to worry about what my destination is, because I've already received him. You have already have accepted God, so you don't have to worry about what's going on this earth. All you have to do is just continue to serve God, continue to help each other, and continue to keep God first. I love what I used to hear so many times by Spencer Taylor. He used to tell me over the years, if you just keep God first, God will keep the enemy off your back.
Yes.
See, sometimes you have an enemy who likes to ride right along with you. And every now and then you wonder why your back hurts so bad. It's because the enemy has been catching a ride for so long. But yet, God, we talking about a God that removes us from darkness and puts us in light. We talking about a God who removes us from being unclean to being clean. We talking about a God who removes us from the knowledge, from the unknowledge, to having some knowledge. We talking about a God that removes us from being blind to having sight. We talking about a God who is able to take care of all of our needs according to his riches in Christ Jesus. You and I have so much to be excited about when we are walking in the light of God.
Yes.
And sometimes we have to just thank God.
Thank
I cannot get complacent in my walk with God.
All right.
Because when you begin to think about where you have come from, it helps us to know that God is still providing.
Right.
Can't nobody understand about what you have gone through. But we as people have a tendency to say, I understand where you're coming from. And yet we have not had a relationship
all
with
right.
God. We have not had a talk with God.
Yeah.
We have not had no dealing with
all
God.
Right.
But God is the light of the world.
Yeah.
See, every now and then I find myself, as well as you might find yourself, you might be walking in the day at one point, and then in the next moment, you might find yourself walking out in the midst of the darkness. See, when I begin to look around, I begin to see how God is moving. Because in each lap, you see a little light coming through the bulb. But yet, I see they have to be fed by something. And I found out in our lives that God is the source of all energy. I found out that God is the source of all knowledge and help. You and I sometimes find ourselves going through some hard situations where you can confide in God. You might find yourself going through some difficult circumstances, but you can find hope.